Signaling in general is a hot topic among model railroaders. There are plenty of discussions and videos about it, and as it seems, a lot of confusion as well. After watching what feels like 20,000 YouTube videos on the topic, it seems to me that at least some of the confusion is the result of people just jumping on details and exceptions rather than first trying to gain a good understanding of the underlying fundamentals. So, with this video I am trying to go the other way, strictly talking fundamentals and basic principles, and answers for frequently asked questions like where to place signals along the track and how to wire a layout for prototypical signaling will hopefully be answered as a byproduct. Hello YouTubers and welcome to the Internet of Toy Trains. I'm Hans Tanner and here is a new episode of IoTT with fresh ideas about how to use IoT components to control a model railroad layout. Let's get started! If you have followed this channel for a few weeks, you probably know why I'm looking into this topic. It started out with video number 9, when I built the first version of the picture frame CTC panel. I soon figured out that I had no signals on my test track, so I built a signaling system starting with video number 13. With that system now in place, I am looking for ways to develop the CTC panel so that it can provide automated block signaling and even real CTC functionality without an additional computer running software like JMRI and the like. And since I am interested in concepts that are general enough to put them into universal code, I am now researching the fundamentals of signaling. The goal thereby is to program the CTC panel in a way that it can be adapted to any individual layout by setting a few parameters. When talking with model railroaders, I get the impression we are all signaling system experts. After all, signals are just a collection of red, yellow, and green lamps that tell the engineer whether he is allowed to proceed and if so, with what speed. Not much different than what we experience on a daily basis in road traffic, right? Well, wrong. There is much more to railroad signaling, and I think part of the reason for a lot of confusion really is that many of us are too fast in comparing railroad signaling systems to traffic lights, which we all know and understand. So, in this first section, I am trying to work out those differences and talk about what that means for railroad signaling. And if you want to do some research for yourself, I have listed some of my favorite sources in the description section of this video. Here is the main reason why railroad signaling is so much different than road traffic signals, 0.6 versus 1.0. 0.6 is the static friction coefficient of dry steel on steel. Compare this to rubber on dry asphalt, where the coefficient is about 1.0. What this means is that compared to road traffic, braking forces at the wheel of a train can only be about 60% of those at the car wheel with the same load. This results in much longer braking distances for the same speed and mass. Furthermore, trains are heavy compared to cars, which further increases the braking distance of a train. In fact, stopping a freight train traveling at track speed can take up to 2 miles, while bringing a car that is going with the same speed to a full stop only takes a few dozen feet. In road traffic, motorists should be able to stop their vehicle within the distance they can see ahead, and in difficult situations even in half of that distance. Trains cannot maintain a reasonable speed while going by this general rule, so for going fast, the engineer needs to have a way to see the track condition beyond the visible track ahead. And this is the primary role of signals. Let the engineer know about what's coming while there is still time to react and prepare. To deal with these problems, railroad signaling employs two concepts that are fundamentally different from signaling and in road traffic. Here is the first. Train movements on main tracks are always planned movements from location A to location B. Look, when I want to go somewhere with my car, all I need to do is hop in the car and go. And as I go, I watch the traffic around me and react as needed. I slow down, accelerate, go with the flow, and when the road narrows, I may stop and let other traffic pass. Of course, this is not possible if you are running a 15,000-ton freight train. There is no way to turn around or briefly go off track to make room to cross. Passing or crossing another train is only possible in locations with an accessible parallel track. Such locations are called interlocking plants or interlocking and serve, okay, that's somewhat simplified, as origin or destination for any movements on a main track. So, a train movement normally is a unidirectional move from interlocking A to interlocking B without stopping or changing direction. Some exceptions are possible for delivering or picking up cars to or from a siding along the route, but this does not question the general rule. And the second principle? If a train movement is a planned and coordinated move, then somebody has to plan and authorize it, and that is the second conceptual difference to road traffic. See, on a road, all participants have a general permission to move, and only for some particularly dangerous locations like intersections, a special permission is needed and typically granted by a traffic light. In railroading, the concepts of movement authorization and movement safety are on two different levels. As a general rule, no one is allowed to use a railroad main track unless he is authorized by the governing body. To issue an authorization, the governing body verifies that the track to be used is free and available and then grants permission for a specific track and a specific time slot. Thereby, the permission can be a piece of paper that is handed to the engineer, or it can be in the form of a signal aspect or even a verbal communication. The form is not important. The important thing is the concept of having two different layers of authority. One for the general permission to move from one interlocking to the next, and then a more detailed layer that defines the speed at each location along the track to be used. And again, this lower layer may or may not consist of light signals, but alternate means are possible as well. Besides those two conceptual differences, there is also a technical difference many people are not aware of, and that is the informational content of signal aspects. In road traffic, a traffic light indicates a permission to use the road or lane right at the location of the signal. Again, this is possible because the motorist is able to bring his vehicle to a stop from the moment he can see the signal until the moment he is about to cross the stopping line. Because this is impossible for a train engineer, railroad signals do not primarily indicate the speed at the location of the signal, but a certain braking distance after the signal. Typically, this will be the speed at the location of the next signal. The speed at the location of the current signal should basically be old news, because it has been signaled at the previous signal. This becomes clear when looking at the meaning of typical aspects, like here some examples from BNSF. This means the engineer can pass the current signal at the current speed, but has to make sure that he is not faster than 60 miles an hour at the next signal. You can go through all aspects. You will see the same pattern. The signal always shows the speed at the current location as a reminder and the speed at the next signal location as new information. Plus, in some cases, it has an informational content like diverging route, which has no impact on the engineer's actions except in areas where turnouts are operated by members of the train crew. For example, when a train has to move into a siding between interlocks in order to let another train pass. With these concepts, we have pretty much covered the basics of railroad traffic. Everything that comes now has to do with traffic efficiency. For example, moving more trains in a shorter time span while still maintaining the same safety level. That really is what is at the core of all signaling systems, increasing the efficiency of a track while maintaining safety. Let's look into some examples to make this better understandable. The first example shows the traffic control principles I just explained. This is pretty much what it used to be in the 60s and 70s of the last century where I grew up. There was maybe a train between stations A to B about once an hour in each direction. To send a train, the head of station A would call station B and they would agree to let the train go from A to B. Then they would set the home signals, do a brake inspection on the train and dispatch it. After passing the home signal, it would change back to red, same with the home signal in station B. The train would arrive and the movement would be complete. The track between the stations was non-signaled territory and of course only one train could be in this area at the same time. But the example visualizes the dual level concept of train movement authorization provided by the yardmaster and train movement execution performed by the engineer. With increasing demand for transportation, this system soon came to its limits. But how would it be possible to run more trains between two locations? There are only two ways to achieve this: increasing travel speed or reducing the time between trains following each other. But how can either of these be done without compromising safety, given the physical limitations of the installed tracks and the slippery characteristics of the wheel rail system, as we discussed? Over the years, several concepts to increase throughput of a given track system were introduced: double track with dedicated direction, block systems with automated signaling or absolute permissive blocks, or even moving block systems. And the authorization went from local to centralized traffic control in order to achieve better network-wide coordination. We will look into these concepts in the next video, so stay tuned. As always, I hope the information in this video was useful or at least interesting for you. If so, please click the like button below and subscribe to the channel. I appreciate your support as well as any feedback in the comments section below. Also, check out the additional information provided in the description below. If you don't want to miss any future IoTT videos, click the bell icon and you will get a notification when the video comes out. Thanks for watching and see you next time!